Good evening, Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter. This is Rich again, back for your second and final video blog of the night for Thursday, November 26, 2015, around 8 p.m. in Billerica, Massachusetts. Sun went down, it was a nice day. Highs in the 50s in New England. Hopefully you had a lot of turkey and cranberry sauce and pumpkin pie and stuffing and others. Hopefully you had Thanksgiving dinner at a home and spend it with your family. Now it's on to Black Friday and Christmas. Some news to report. There was two football games in the NFL this afternoon. The Detroit Lions crushed the Philadelphia Eagles. And the Carolina Panthers are 11-0. They beat up on the Dallas Cowboys. I picked the Cowboys to tan the Panthers their first loss of the season, but I was wrong on that. And Tony Romo got injured again, hurt his collarbone. The Cowboys now have 8 losses, and it's going to be very tough for them to make the playoffs. But the NFC East is a bad division this year, and 8-8 could get them to win the division. But if Romo's going to miss the rest of the season, it's impossible. And sad news to report in the world of professional wrestling. Longtime professional wrestler Tommy Gilbert passed away at the age of 75. Tommy wrestled in many southern territories in the United States in the 60s and 70s. His sons also were professional wrestlers, the late great Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert and Dirty Doug Gilbert, also all wrestlers. So prayers to his family. That's about it on the news. My second and final video blog subject tonight is my review of Survivor Series 1995 WWE pay-per-view from Landover, Maryland, from the Capitol Center, or it was branded as the U.S. Air Arena at that time. The main event was a no-holds-barred match for the WWE title. It was Big Daddy Cool Diesel, who was the champion at the time, defending against Bret the Hitman Hart. They had some great Survivor Series 4-on-4 matches on this card, and also another singles match. Before the pay-per-view, they had a dark match. It was the Smoking Guns, who were WWE Tag Team Champions, facing off against Public Enemy, and who was like Johnny Grunge and Rocko Rock. And the Smoking Guns won this match by pinfall. And this was the Public Enemy's tryout match for the WWE. They weren't too good, so they didn't sign with WWE. They eventually signed with WCW. And these were the matches that were on the pay-per-view card, which was called by Vince McMahon, good old JR, Jim Ross, and Mr. Perfect. The first match was a 4-on-4 elimination Survivor Series match. It was the Body Donnas, who was Skip, and Dr. Tom Pritchard, and Rad Rafford, and the 1-2-3 Kid, with Sonny and the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase, facing off against the underdogs, which was Barry Horowitz, and Marty Jannetty, and Hakushi, and Bob Sparkplug Holly. This was a great match. Couldn't believe that Barry Horowitz was in a Survivor Series match. Actually, he was in a Survivor Series match 2 years before, but he was under a hood. And it was back and forth. The ending had like Marty Jannetty on the underdogs facing off against the 1-2-3 Kid of the Body in the Body Donnas group. And Psycho Sid interferes, when the referee was distracted by the Million Dollar Man. He attacks Jannetty, and the 1-2-3 Kid pins Jannetty for 1-2-3, and the 1-2-3 Kid survives. The sole survivor, the 1-2-3 Kid just turned heel and joined the Million Dollar Corporation. The next match was a 4-on-4 elimination women's match. This was the first women's match on a WWE Survivor Series pay-per-view since the first one. It had Bertha Faye, Aja Khan, Tomoko Warner B, and Lance Asato facing off against the WWE Women's Champion, Alonda Blaze, Kotsosi Nuyo, Sasuke Hasasino and Chababins Asana. I don't know too much pronunciation for Japanese. These might not be like pronunciations, the real ones, but I don't know too much about Japanese, so just bear with me. And this was, and Bertha Fay was with Dr. Harvey Whippleman. And this was like an okay match and stuff. A lot of the Japanese women were high flyers and stuff. Very exciting match. It was awesome. The ending had Alundra Blaze facing off against Aja Khan. Aja Khan had like this very short hair and she had face paint and stuff. And Aja Khan pins Alundra Blaze. And she's the sole survivor for her team. And the next feud was going to be Aja Khan against Alundra Blaze for the WWE Women's title. But Alundra Blaze's contract wasn't renewed. A few weeks later, after Survivor Series 1995, she goes on WCW Monday Nitro and throws the WWE Women's title in the trash. That was one of the lowest moments in WCW Nitro history. She buried the Women's title. Vince McMahon didn't use the Women's title, didn't bring it back for 3 years. The next match was a one-on-one singles match. It was Bam Bam Bigelow facing off against Goldust. And this was Goldust's first Survivor Series match. And it was, he was playing mind games on Bam Bam Bigelow and stuff like that. Bam Bam tried to do some his high-flying moves that he missed. And Goldust used the Bulldog, the running Bulldog, to pin Bam Bam Bigelow for the 1, 2, 3. Goldust wins another match. And this was Bam Bam Bigelow's last WWE match ever. He didn't return to the lead in sports entertainment for the rest of his career and stuff. The next match was another 4-on-4 Elimination Survivor Series matchup. It was the Dark Side, captained by The Undertaker, Henry O. Godwin, Savio Vega, and a man who makes a difference, Batu, facing off against the Royals, which was captained by, the Dark Side was managed by Paul Bearer, and the Royals had King Mabel, the captain. I am the king! He was along with Hunter Hearst Helmsley, Triple H, Jerry the King Lawler, and Isaac Yankem DDS. Isaac Yankem became Kane. And this match was just basically a show for The Undertaker because he tombstoned Jerry the King Lawler, and then he tombstoned Isaac Yankem. He chokeslammed Triple H, and then King Mabel runs like crazy. So the Dark Side survives, all 14 members. Another Survivor Series teams that had survived. The next match was a wild card match. And this was a very unusual Survivor Series match. It was a 4-on-4 elimination. They mixed up some faces and heels and just scattered them about. It was Team Michaels, captained by Shawn Michaels. He had the British Bulldog, Davey Boy Smith, Psycho Sid, and Ahmed Johnson. And that team was worth Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase, facing off against Team Yokozuna, which Yokozuna had Dean Douglas, The Rocket Owen Hart, also the King of Hearts, and the WWE Intercontinental Champion, Razor Ramon, and they were with Mr. Fuji, and Jim Cornette was going both sides because he managed Bulldog and Owen Hart and stuff. And this was an unusual match and stuff. They had interference by the 1-2-3 kid. He attacked Razor Ramon and stuff. Shawn Michaels accidentally hit Psycho Sid with the super kick and stuff like that. It was just a crazy match and kind of a good concept. And the ending had Ahmed Johnson slam Yokozuna. And the survivors of this match were the British Bulldog, Shawn Michaels, and Ahmed Johnson. Afterwards, Shawn Michaels and Ahmed Johnson attacked the British Bulldog. That was a fun match. And the main event was for the WWE World Championship. It was under no holds barred match. It was Big Daddy Cool Diesel facing off, who was the WWE champion, facing off against Bret the Hitman Hart. And this was a no holds barred match. Both were faces and both were like pulling all the stops to win this match and stuff. Diesel flew Bret the Hitman Hart through a table using some extreme moves. Bret was out of it, and Diesel tried to help him, as a nice guy he was, because he was a face. But Bret surprised him with a small package, and the referee counted 1, 2, 3. Bret the Hitman Hart becomes the WWE champion for the third time. At that time, he was only the second man to hold WWE title on 3 separate occasions, but since then, many other wrestlers have done it. But afterwards, Big Daddy Cool Diesel loses it, and then he powerbombed Bret the Hitman Hart, and he hits the referee, and the fans were booing Diesel. He was turning into a tweener role, which is part good guy, part bad guy, and that was it. What did I think about the Survivor Series 1995? Give it a solid A+, because it was a Survivor Series with some good matches, especially Bret the Hitman Hart versus Diesel. The wild card match was pretty amazing and stuff like that. Also, the women's Survivor Series match was surprisingly good and stuff. And the rest of the card was okay, and it was probably one of the best Survivor Series in the 1990s. That's about it on this. That's about it on these video blogs. Tomorrow, 3 more video blogs back on the regular schedule and stuff like that, because when there's holidays or special occasions, there'll be only 2, but the regulars were 3, maybe could be throwing in a 4th one, could surprise you. These 3 video blogs are coming tomorrow. First video blog will be about the top 10 sports stars ever to wear the number 22. Second video blog will be about the Phantom Gourmet. And the third and final video blog of the night will be my review of Survivor Series 1996. Coming December 1st will be periodically my predictions for 2015. The first predictions I'll be making are from digital television networks over the air, what you could expect, what I'm predicting you could expect from them. Plus, there'll be stuff later on in what about sports media, what's going to happen, sports media, Hall of Fames, and sports predictions, and maybe, just maybe, the presidential race, the 2016 presidential race, how I think it's going to play out. And also in 2016, I might be doing a weekly podcast and getting some guests. And there's a guest I really want. You know who I'm talking about. I don't have to mention that person's name. And see you later. Keep calm. And I'm a Julie Putnam guy. Molly Rosenblatt of WCCO, TV4, in Minneapolis, with her shoulder rocks and has nice legs. Elizabeth Hart, so stunning. And in the words of Vince McMahon, WWE owner, you got no chance in hell. Good night. See you tomorrow.